On March 1st, 2024, the creator of Dragon Ball, Dr. Slump, and the artistic designer of Chrono Trigger, the Dragon Quest games, and many, many more, Akira Toriyama, passed away of subdural hematoma at the all-too-young age of 68. If you were a kid in the 1980s or 1990s, you almost certainly grew up being influenced by his work, whether directly by playing a game or watching an anime he was directly involved with, or one of the innumerable ones that he influenced. It's impossible to imagine animation without him. Especially today, it is impossible to imagine the world of animation without his influence. May he rest in peace.
Yeah, Akira Toriyama was a huge influence for me, like a big inspiration for me artistically. So this hurts. This hurts a lot. Not only do I like Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z a lot, and I do like Dr. Slump a lot, I also love Chrono Trigger. Chrono Trigger is literally my favorite RPG. It's my favorite game on the SNES. It'd definitely be in my top five favorite games, period. I have a problem playing RPGs these days because they're so long, but I will still just play through Chrono Trigger any random chance I get. I love that game so much. But yeah, he was a huge artistic influence on me. And like you said, a lot of manga and anime wouldn't be the same without him. Everything from One Piece to My Hero Academia owes so much to him.
His work has inspired a lot of people to go into anime and manga, not just in Japan, but all over the world. He brings worlds to life, whether they are serious or whether they are funny. He always, through his artwork and everything, has always encouraged people to dream, which I think is an amazing legacy to leave behind. Especially with Chrono Trigger, where it still to this day vibes for against Final Fantasy, I think 6 or 5, for the number one spot for Super Nintendo RPG game. Like, those two constantly fight artistically one of the number one spots as a Super Nintendo role-playing game. They fight between the two, it's which one is better. So, you know, rest in power, Akira Toriyama. You know, you were gone, taken way too quickly.
I just remember being a freshman in high school and going to one of my first all-time big comic book conventions, the fall one. And I just started kind of knowing what anime was and getting fan subs. And my first fan sub I bought was from this anime called Dragon Ball Z, movie number 8, first Broly movie. Took it home and fell in love with the series there. And I'd be saving my lunch money and trying to go to any convention, picking up any fan sub copies I could of any episodes. I just, you know, and then it just got me in love with everything. It kind of entered me into the world of anime and manga. And then about 8 years later, I'd be introduced to the world of Dragon Quest. And so that was just a downward spiral into RPGs for me. And then, you know, and I got introduced to Dr. Slump and, you know, Sandland. And I want to throw this out. People also forget, aside from Chrono Trigger and the Dragon Quest, he was also the art designer for a couple of small, like, Japanese games called Tobal and Tobal 2. I remember getting Tobal 2 when I worked at an anime store called Planet Anime, usually always taking the import games out and playing on a converted PlayStation we had in the back room when people weren't there. So to be a lot of fun. But the man was just, it's one of my favorite artists of all time. And now after this, like, I think it was like this past year and a half, that's two now that in my top all-time artists that have passed away. So farewell, Mr. Toriyama. You will be missed.
Real quick, I do just want to add that the original Dragon Quest was one of the few video games my late sister Catherine really got attached to. So for a game to suck in a non-video game fan like her, like that,
yeah,
was no small feat. And I have to believe it had a lot to do with Toriyama's sense of liveliness in his art, that even relatively primitive 8-bit sprites could still convey. I can't think of any other creator of that time period whose work was that imaginative, that varied, and that expressive. you definitely see it in his influence in One Piece. You see his influence all over the place, you know, even in places you wouldn't expect.
Pimmy and I talked about this, and there have been a few others, but not of that, you're right, not of that time period, not of the late 70s, early 80s. Like, there's been a few others that we know that, and like, one is still with us, Go Nagai, I would say, has had that impact. And then, unfortunately, we lost him last year, but Leiji Matsumoto was another one, I think, really kind of, these are my top kind of favorite manga artists that you didn't know. It's, but Akira really was the one that kind of introduced me and everything, and that, yeah, you're right. It's, I don't think anything has hit worldwide as much as he has.
I mean, his style is so recognizable. And just to be a little girly for a second, I mean, no one could draw slimes as cute as he could.
Nobody would like a slime like he did.
Yeah.
I mean, heck, like, slimes are in, like, every RPG, but if you hear slime, the first thing you think of is a Dragon Quest slime.
Because
so.
they're just so cute. I mean, like, how you look at them, you feel so bad beating them up. Like, I hate beating them up when I play Dragon Quest. Like, I really want to... That's why I love the Heavenly Hand of the Heavenly Bride, because you could actually, like, kind of bring them into your side and use them in to fight with you. Like, that was one of my reasons why I love that game, was like, I can bring the monsters to my side and I don't have to kill them.
Well, I mean, hell, one of my favorite all-time top five favorite games is Rocket Slime for the DS.
Mm-hmm. Akira Toriyama, may you rest in power.
Rest in power.
Rest in power.
There are too many cartoons, but they'll watch them all. The Penny and James gonna sort of hopefully funny cartoon podcast.
Hello, everyone. I'm James Irish.
I'm Pembroke W. Corgi.
I'm Chrissy Harding.
Welcome to the Pemmy, Chrissy, and James kind of, sort of, hopefully funny cartoon podcast. And joining us on the couch this week is Mr. Kylepedia.
Woo!
Plug your stuff, Kyle.
I am Kylepedia, the know-it-all of pop culture. Welcome, 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 as I engage your mind with the youthless knowledge that's stuck in my head.
Oh, he's going to fit in so well. I love it.
As I'm sure you've gathered, we are looking at the work of Akira Toriyama, specifically Dr. Slump, in today's podcast. And, you know, we've given our quick reflections on him, but let's rewind all the way back to the beginning. Few creators hit the ground running from the start, and Akira was no different. In 1978, inspired by an amateur manga contest in Weekly Shonen Magazine that he missed the deadline for, he auditioned for an ongoing contest by competing magazine Weekly Shonen Jump. Impressing his future editor, Kazuhiko Torimisha, his first works, entitled Wonder Island and Wonder Island 2, were nonetheless not well received by audiences. 500 pages of mostly rejected material followed, save for today's Highlight Island, which would be published, while Kazuhiko encouraged him to create a female lead for his next attempt. Toriyama was hesitant, but decided if a one-shot experiment with one succeeds, he'd do it. If it failed, he just wouldn't. And that one-shot was 1979's Tomato the Cutesy Gumshoe. Japan in the 1970s, ladies and gentlemen.
It says a lot, people. It says a lot.
It's funny you mentioned all that manga, because I forgot I had right next to me. I have the Akira Toriyama's Manga Theater, which has all that manga all together right next to me.
All of his one-shots.
Yeah, Wonder Island. Sorry, it's the first one in there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So this tomato turned out to be just ripe enough to get some positive feedback. So, indeed, Kazuhiko won out. And Toriyama then revisited some character ideas from today's Highlight Island and came up with a concept with an altogether different female lead. Entitled Dr. Slump, it centers around inventor Senbei Norimaki and his robotic daughter Arale, the result of his desire to create the perfect little girl robot, making him an inadvertent predecessor to the Powerpuff Girls' Professor Utonium.
Though at the same time kind of parodying Tezuka's Astro Boy.
You're right. I wonder if that was an influence.
I'm pretty sure it was.
I'm sure.
Almost certainly.
Yeah. We could always break out the Ouija board and ask. Or is that too soon? Too soon?
Too soon.
Too soon.
The last time I did that, it just kept weakly crying for Mario. And then I realized I had a Luigi board.
Ah! Well, you're less likely to get evil spirits with that one.
Despite Arale being intended to be a supporting character, since Toriyama first wanted the stories to be strictly about Senbai, she was clearly the eventual favorite of the series. This father-daughter duo live in Penguin Village amidst any number of other odd residents, where Senbai's eccentricities and Arale's naivete inevitably collide with the rest of the village. Puns, pop culture parodies, and toilet humor all ensue in their wake.
And any Ultraman cameo Toriyama can throw at you.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Japan in the 1970s, ladies and gentlemen.
First published in Shonen Jump on February 4th of 1980, Dr. Slump would be Toriyama's first true success, leading to a television series the following year on Fuji TV that would run until 1986.
That's a good run.
Yeah.
Yeah. For over 200 episodes.
Nice.
Nice.
We'll get more into the premise in just a little bit. But since we are going to be looking at the first two episodes, we may as well just discuss that as it comes up. But let's quickly look at some of the performers. Arale's actress is the prolific Mami Koyama, who would reprise the character in Dragon Ball, as well as voice that series' character Lunch, as well as numerous roles that, you know, I'll be perfectly honest, I have such a lack of familiarity with Japanese voice actors, I couldn't tell you which ones are and aren't important.
Hey, she did voice Fujiko in the Fuma Conspiracy.
Ooh,
okay. The third, the Fuma Conspiracy.
That's right. That's right. I remember seeing that.
And which is funny because one of the other voice actors in this was also in that, but I'll get to that later. But she was in a Mobile Suit Gundam as a Kaecilia Zabi. And she was in Space Pirate Captain Harlock and following thing within the same series, Queen Millennium. And for all you, and she was Ryoko Mindo in Yersia Yatsura, which was the girl that was raised by a boy. So she's got a lot of personal confusion. And for all you people who used to watch Nickelodeon, she was also in the Mysterious Cities of Gold as Zia.
Really?
Oh, nice.
Okay. So Kenji Utsumi performs Senbai. He's otherwise known for lending his voice to such anime as Fist of the North Star, Sally the Witch, Full Metal Alchemist, and performing the voice of the dragon Shenlong in Dragon Ball, as well as being the dubbing voice for actors ranging from Jack Nicholson to Sammy Davis Jr.?
What?
He was very prolific.
Very multi-talented, too.
Yeah, if you're going to do Sammy, you got to have some range.
He also, I think, showed up on some episodes of Iron Chef, the original Iron Chef. And he's pretty much was known as like kind of, he's kind of Japan's version of Dom Messick. So I think kind of the parallel to make. Yeah, he does a lot. He does a lot. I just also want to throw this out real quickly. To my friend Kentaro, I apologize for any mess-ups to the Japanese names we make. You can yell at me later. I just remembered I have to put that kind of out there because he's always like, I will be paying attention. I'm like, screw you. So, sorry, Ken. But yeah, he's a really versatile actor, voice actor in Japan. I mean, I don't even think this is even an eighth of the list of what he's done.
Numerous more characters appear, but since each has their own individual voice actor and there's no overlap, like in a lot of Western properties, we'll mention them as they appear in the show.
Real quick, interesting fact, he was married to Michiko Nomura, who was the voice of Trixie in Speed Racer in Japan.
Nice.
Yeah.
Ah.
Now, there's two major characters of note, however, who do not appear in the episodes we look at that bear mentioning, and this is probably the best opportunity to quickly bring them up. we've got the cherubic Gachan, who shows up having hatched from an egg brought back from prehistoric times in the very next episode, episode 3, and is performed by Seiko Nakano. The other important character is Senbei's rival, Dr. Mashirito, another mad scientist who slowly becomes more robotic as his exploits in Penguin Village keep backfiring on him. He goes through a lot of voice actors, starting with Akio Nojima, and he'd be most frequently performed by Noichi Nozawa.
If I remember right, that character was based on Toriyama's editor.
Yes. Mashirito was indeed inspired by Toriyama's previously mentioned editor, Kazuhiko Torishima, where he said to make him patterned after whoever he can't stand. At that point, that was Torishima. Hence, the name becomes the syllables in reverse. Torishima Mashirito.
Nice.
He kind of walked into that one, didn't he?
Well, you know, don't ask questions you don't want the answers to. Also, can we give Toriyama a big, like, we have to give him big kudos, because how many people could actually in very blatantly give their boss a big screw you in such a way? And the boss can't say anything because it's making money.
The only company I can think that happens is the WWE.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
You get to beat up your boss there.
Exactly.
That's true. But like,
less,
I mean,
said about that boss, the better, please.
Yes.
Yes. But I mean, think about it. Like, here he is. He creates this character. And if someone's like, yeah, what inspired you to create him? It's just like, I based him off someone I can't stand. Points to the big guy upstairs. Like, you can't say anything because it's a hit.
So, are we ready to dive in?
Yes.
Yep.
As ready as we're ever going to be.
Okay. Just from this intro, my first impression, you know, before we even get to the title card, I'm getting vibes I haven't felt since we watched the Tomfoolery show. Because we have a bird that represents Toriyama, since Tori is bird, I think.
Yep.
Randomly drawing lines, and that breaks to reveal Ultraman bringing up the sun with a fishing rod. All before we get our title, Arale is born.
Funny thing is, Toriyama uses this bird representation for a bit, but then he changes over to this robot that he uses for like the rest of the series in Dragon Ball and on, that kind of looks like a robotic Sniffit from Super Mario Brothers.
Wearing a gas mask.
Yep.
I wonder if by then the Super Mario Brothers game came out and he just liked that design a little better.
I don't know.
Not possible.
I think it could have been the other way around, honestly.
And it's going to be that way for some other things I'll mention towards the end of the podcast.
Fair enough. Also, I want to point out with the opening of this, a lot of anime shows open this way. Rama 1/2 does too, as I'm sure Pemi can attest to.
Yeah.
Attest to. The very catchy and real crazy opening, showing all the characters running on screen.
I like how in the opening animation, there's multiple scenes of Senbei trying to get like the attention of the camera.
Yes.
Failing.
Which is completely his character.
So a wind-up pig, whose name just translates to Pig-chan, announces the morning to the citizenry of Penguin Village as we look in on Senbei's home where Arale is being built. He finished her head first, meaning she won't stop complaining of boredom.
That is a good gag, to be honest.
And he comments on it, too. He goes, I shouldn't have built the head first.
Maybe you should have said and it turned on the head first. Still a great gag.
It is a great
testing
gag.
One of the arms, she nearly doubles him over with pain from the strike.
Right in the crotch.
Good shot.
I hope he didn't have a heavy breakfast.
He doesn't look like he's skipping on breakfast anytime soon.
No. But I do love how the fact that they go like to straight like full size adult male back to his schlumpy old chubby self.
They love that gag a lot.
Yeah.
Once she's all attached, Arali observes she's flat-chested. And Senpai replies it's enough for a kid.
I mean, yeah. He's not wrong.
No, but I love, and we'll get into it, but I love how, like, oh, certain parts that she's missing will come into play later.
We're gonna get there. Quickly getting her some of his own clothes to cover her lack of anything gender-related, actually, they see how well she can walk and run. She still needs to work on stopping, apparently.
Yeah.
Well, she's not pretty good. I mean, she didn't run through the equipment. She just ran into it. Which, considering her strength ability, you think it'd be more damaged.
Which also is a good timed gag in the fact it looks like that. It looks like it's going to fall on Arali and it falls on Senpai instead.
Mm-hmm.
That is good.
Next, facial expressions. As a wave of emotions flies over Arali's face, one's contrary to Senpai's orders, actually. He remarks about his genius in pompous, mad scientist style while being drawn more realistically.
Mm-hmm.
But Arali has ideas way past what he intended and seems disappointed she can't fly, shoot missiles, or lasers.
Or fight bad guys. I did read somewhere that when they go into that realistic style, that's actually how Senpai sees himself. It's like he goes into his mind and that's how he's seeing himself.
Gotcha.
Yeah. That feels in character.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I was reading somewhere, and when I said something to Ken about it while we were watching it, I said, I read this somewhere. He goes, no, that actually is very early anime. He goes, anime style was when they went realistic on a comic, a more comedic one, was when you were inside the character's head. He says that was an actual technique they did in the more comedic shows.
So then she thinks she sees something wrong with his face. And it turns out she's got a vision impairment.
How do you make an android with a vision impairment? Seriously.
I think this plays more into Senpai not being quite as good as he thinks he is. Because we realize he messes up quite a bit with Ariel.
I mean, a possibility that his own figurative short-sightedness translates into Arale's literal short-sightedness.
Probably.
Yeah. There you go. or you know, maybe optical lenses weren't so good in 1978.
I don't know, but he apparently has a pair of glasses right there that are the perfect correction for this. So
yeah, once handed to her, she sees clearly and identifies her creator as a gorilla.
Like I said, perfect for vision.
He sets out to get her some clothes, reasoning she can't live in his pajamas. And she wants a mink coat.
Girls got taste.
I agree with Senpai in the fact that where did you hear these things?
I wonder just how much attention Senpai was paying when he set up her artificial intelligence. And I'm sure the answer is whatever lack of attention makes for the funniest result.
Fair enough. I also think Senpai just programmed whatever he thought women work with. Because we're going to learn later, he doesn't really understand women too well. In the next 2 seconds, actually.
We check back in as he has one item left on his shopping list. Underwear.
Hold on. So I'm actually following along with the manga on my Shonen Jump app. And the outside of the store actually has a sign that says everything, diapers and missiles half off.
I want to go shop at that place.
No kidding.
But yes, underwear. Because of course. Rather than just explain he's doing emergency shopping for his daughter, he goes about the mad task of cross-dressing and shaving his mustache in order for people to not think he's some kind of pervert. As if this weren't wild enough, he had asked a clerk for a gift for his mother, mm-hmm. and that clerk handed him a schoolgirl uniform, which fits him perfectly.
But can I just say, the guy with his head turned to the side, not creepy?
No, not creepy at all. None whatsoever. And I love how Senpai even points out, I get something from a mother and he hands me a school uniform. Like, what is wrong with him? Like, I love how Senpai even calls out, like, this is weird. This is weird.
The capper on this gag is when he finally gets around to asking for the undergarments. and he's shown a massive pear with an elephant on it.
Mm-hmm. And he flips himself. Oh, Lord.
Yeah, falling over seems to be the majority of the exercise he gets.
You know, it's Japan, it's the 70s, and men are drawing this. This is all I'm going to say.
Well, I will say, as someone who was married and did have a I still
have a kid,
but I still have a kid, but I had to deal with a kid being young. I've been on trips for stuff like that that guys normally don't get. And yeah, it is embarrassing the first couple of times, but after a while, you just get used to it.
Yeah, I would say there are just some things. There are certain things you send men to the store for, and there's certain things you don't send men to the store for. Underwear is one of them. The other one is any feminine hygiene products.
Unfortunately, I got sent for those a lot.
That's when you did something wrong and we're out to get back at you.
Or, you know, your wife is lazy. But anyways.
Normally, this is the point where I'd be having questions. But there will be no invoking of, now wait just a minute, on Dr. Slump. I save that for shows that either mostly hew closer to reality or try to take on non-comedic tones. Dr. Slump is clearly neither of those things.
Yeah, it is.
So I have a much easier time turning off my brain and just laughing with it than I would something that's actually trying to be serious.
You mean like how the Super Friends, like, use their robot duplicates to...
Yes!
We shouldn't re-traumatize him over that. It's too soon.
It was such a great response, though.
It was, though, because it was the perfect response to
so,
that.
While I do have questions, let's be honest, they scarcely matter, just so long as it's funny.
Yeah, just don't apply logic to this show.
It's back at Senbai's home, the clothes are perfect for Orale, who, by the way, hasn't been named yet. That becomes important later. And he's relieved as Toriyama Bird announces to the world the inventor's mustache has returned.
Yeah.
Yay!
And I thought I grew facial hair fast.
He sneezed and it came back.
Taking a stroll, Senbai observes that so long as nobody knows she's a robot, he succeeded. Which is followed by her once again playing catch with her own head.
Again.
Yeah. Second time in the episode.
Well, if nobody knows she's a robot, how is he going to win? How is he like, you know, I'm the greatest inventor. If nobody knows it, what's the point?
It's a personal achievement.
Yeah. I think to him, it's like, if I can fool everyone that she's not a robot, and then I reveal she's a robot, they'll be amazed by the fact that I was able to create the perfect robot.
It's all an ego trip.
Yeah, pretty much is what that is.
So a coffee pot shaped building is our next destination. And according to Toriyama Bird, that's Aoi-chan's workplace. Aoi Kimidori is performed by Naomi Jinbo and consistently calls Dr. Slump the wrong name, Dr. Skunk. He introduces Arale to her as his kid sister, saying he's too young to have a daughter at 28. When Aoi asks the kid's name, Senbai realizes he forgot that part, and his stammers quickly are adopted by the kid, Arale. Since their names are based on rice-based biscuits and crackers, Aoi thinks it's a joke, lampshading the whole bit.
But no, that's just Toriyama, because, I mean, needless to say, one of the biggest bad guys in Dragon Ball Z's name is based on Freezer. So,
yeah.
Not to mention Pilaf.
Don't forget, and almost all the Saiyans are based off of vegetables.
Or Bibbidi Bobbidi and Boo.
Boo. Mm-hmm.
Or come on, Gohan after lunch.
Yep.
And going backwards from that, let's not forget Tomato the Cutie Detective.
Yeah. That's fair.
He likes his pun names, which I can relate to. Actually, he's probably responsible for why I kind of do that, too.
Fair enough.
Anywho, placing orders, Arale wants to drink motor oil.
That's fair.
Speed Buggy would approve.
In fact, everything that comes out of her mouth seems to be liable to give away the secret, and Dr. Slump can't stop falling over in comedic panic. Finally, Aoi looks closely at Arale and notices she has no nostrils. But Dr. Slump has an answer for this. It's a manga! And in manga, nobody has nostrils!
Technically, it's an anime. Manga is the comic book.
Well, it's using the dialogue from the manga, so there you go.
Fair enough.
Well, look, they played it back into Dragon Ball with when Krillin in the first Tenchi Budokai.
Yeah, they did do that.
That is fair.
As Aoi realizes this herself, Senpai says this is getting too silly and they should go. And Arale says an adorable goodbye.
Goodbye, 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 bye!
And walks out into the street.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. Takes out a cop car.
Arale says, F the police.
Arale was the first protester.
Actually, if she's saying F the police, it probably means friend the police because she's too innocent to not think anything else like that.
That's fair.
I love that the cop car hits her, gets completely destroyed, and yet she's worried about is her...
Her clothes get torn.
Her overalls is torn.
Just like, I tore my clothes. I tore my clothes. Like, because she just got the clothes. Like, she's a little, you know, she's just like, I don't know if she's upset that she tore her clothes or she's just like, am I in trouble? Or she's just like, oh, I tore my clothes. What do we do?
Probably that one.
Yeah.
After the commercial break, we enter into the second segment, Hi Friends, which will see Arale going to school for the first time. We get some more of Toriyama's visually imaginative humor as a Superman pastiche flies by.
There's actually a brief cameo of him in the supermarket. I mean, not supermarket, but in the shop scene earlier in his Clark Kent get up.
Oh. And that is not going to be the last Superman pastiche this show will feature either.
Oh, no.
Gets around by skateboarding on his belly.
And getting power from, I think his name is Superman. And he gets his powers from eating pickled plums or something like that. It's been a while.
Yeah, Superman tends to show up quite a bit in animes around this in the 80s and the 90s, both as either backgrounds or stuff like that. It's interesting how often he shows up in the background of animes at this time period. So I'm not surprised. Like, there's these little pastiches popping up.
Well, come on, he's the father of Project Echo.
Yeah,
I was about to say that was actually the one I was thinking about was Project Echo. Where he's the father and Wonder Woman's
the mother. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's also like in the 70s, I think that's when American comics really started appearing a lot more frequently in Japan. So,
yeah.
60s and 70s.
So while he said she needs to be to make sure she gets up early, it turns out Dr. Slump should have worried more about himself oversleeping and not his robotic kid. So to wake him up, she drops a hand grenade in his mouth!
It worked!
Shouldn't that have been the end of the manga right there?
I think the best part of that is he was sleeping so hard that
he chewed
that explosion, he just thought he had a bad dream.
Yeah, like, the dude can deep sleep, and he chewed on the grenade. He wasn't even so much he just dropped it in there. He chewed on it, too.
I might be a little envious of how deep he can sleep.
I am. I'm totally envious of him. I want that ability to sleep that hard.
Also, on the way into school, she still can't stop taking her head off right when the doctor worries about her revealing she's a robot.
I want to mention this. I love the background stuff. I like the little kappa they had in the river as they're going over the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
I love all of the random Ultraman appearances.
Exactly.
Why precisely is he hanging from things like a koala?
Because Toriyama probably thought it was funny.
Because it's cute.
Well, yeah.
Also, you can tell this is the late 70s, early 80s because of so many characters smoking.
I know.
Which you don't really see so common anymore.
At the school, which is named for the audience by its weather vane, Senbai explains that Arale spent a lot of time in the hospital sick and has memory loss. The principal, though, remembers Senbai's parents died when he was young, so he has to change his story to she's his daughter. At that scandalous thought, an attractive blonde lady enters the office. Hello, nurse!
Yep.
This is homeroom teacher Midori Yamabuki, performed by Mariko Mukai. And of course, Senbai is madly in love with her at first sight.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of... She has a lot of time in this series.
Oh, yeah.
He also switches the story back to being Arale's brother, angrily telling the principal his previous explanation was a joke.
And complete with a face transformation that even the principal notices.
I love how self-aware that this show is sometimes.
In class, Arale is sat next to Akane Kimidori, voiced by Kazuko Sugiyama, who also doesn't seem to care much for what's going on. But when Arale tickles her face with her hair to get Akane's attention, she spits her bubble gum into the hair of the student in front of her. Also, in the first lesson, Arale's interpretation of the math problems in Japanese is downright wild. Number one, one kitten of pond carp is frog. Number two, chick divided by elephant trunk is mole tail. Number three, the square root of field horse tail is wasp. Number four, 0 point turtle minus gorilla equals whale.
Yeah, I was watching this with Ken, and because we were on Facebook Messenger because he wanted to watch it with me. And I literally paused and I go, what the blank is that? And he was dying laughing, and he just looked at me and goes, it's a Japanese culture thing.
Yeah. In the manga, they actually use like hieroglyphics and symbols. They're not even mentioning any animals.
Yeah. He just said, I'm not kidding you. He's like, there's no translation into English that's gonna make sense. It's literally a Japanese culture thing of the 70s. He goes, if you said this to my parents, they would start dying laughing. They would think it was the most hilarious thing ever. He goes, it's just something from culture. He goes, it can't explain it. And I'm like, okay.
Midori looks at the book and says, Arale is right? She must be too stunned to say much else about it. I mean, I'd be.
Yeah, I would be too.
Science class is next, and hey! Arale's classmates include a Frankenstein's monster and a vampire!
Thank you.
Glad somebody pointed that out.
I'm just happy you referred to it as Frankenstein's monster and not Frankenstein.
But it is Frankenstein, yes. Robbie.
No. It's not.
If anything, this is proof that Dr. Slump isn't trying to hide the fact that she's a robot because he's afraid people will be weirded out.
Yeah, I mean, literally, Frankenstein's monster is a...
Right there.
Is a shimmering corpse of multiple origins.
But, you know, he goes on to be in Dragon Ball, too.
Yep.
Yeah. Nope, he's just doing it because ego.
So the class are about to dissect frogs, when it turns out Arale has performed an appendectomy and revived the cadaverous frog. Who thanks her?
I got a question. Do kids still dissect frogs in high school? Is that still a thing?
I haven't talked to any of my science teachers, so I don't know.
Yes, they still do, actually. As a former science teacher, they still do, yeah. They actually dissect cats.
I'll admit, I cheaped out on that. I got really squeamish and just let my lab partner do all the work and just wrote down his, copied his stuff. He was fine with it. I couldn't deal with it.
I thought I was going to be squeamish about it, but I really actually wasn't once I did it. Of course, then I became a biology teacher in a previous life. But no, they still do frogs. And now you actually get a choice that you can dissect a cat.
Yeah. Well, they had that when I was in high school.
Yeah.
You. Yeah. I don't like that.
No! No!
like that.
This is worse trauma than the robot duplicates. Poor Kitty.
Let's continue on.
So Jim is next, and the instructor wants to do softball throwing tests.
Yeah, I can already see what's coming here.
I like that the gym teacher's head literally looks like a badminton. Like,
yes, yes, I saw it. I was like, oh my god, I love the drawing of that. That's awesome.
As the softball tosses get longer with each kid, Orale tosses it out of sight, and the measuring staffer says he'll need travel expenses covered for it. It circles the globe, derailing a train, almost upskirting the Statue of Liberty, distressing the Sphinx, bowling over penguins, and returns from whence it came with stickers from all over the place.
Yeah.
And you know what? I don't often see a style of joke that's prevalent in one side of the world's sense of humor so excellently duplicated on the other side. So kudos.
It was very well done. I was vastly amused by that, and I was like, Looney Tunes are proud of you. Good job.
After school, Orale still hangs around Akane by the end of her coat as a pair of kids try to topple a vending machine. These are Taro and Pisuke, Toromame. The former, the older bad boy brother voiced by Toshio Furukawa. The latter, the funny animal hat-wearing kid brother performed by Naomi Jimbo.
Can I talk about Toshio Furukawa?
Of course.
Because, yeah, for the most part, when it comes to voice actors, I'm much more knowledgeable about English voice actors and recognizing them. But as soon as Taro started talking, especially when I heard him laugh, I instantly knew that was the same voice actor as Ataru Moriboshi from Yuri on Yatsura, and I was right. I went to verify that, and I went down a path that I didn't know, because seemingly he's also the voice of Piccolo in Dragon Ball Z.
Really?
And I've watched multiple Japanese Dragon Ball Zs, and I never connected him to Ataru. He's also the voice of Taizo Hori, a.k.a. Dig Dug, in Namco X Capcom in the Mr. Driller series. So throw that one out there, too.
It's a small world.
So the vending machine comes to life to tell them to stop and sasses them with spittle until they properly pay. It's hard being a delinquent in a comedy anime. Akane and Orale approach the boys, and they try to act tough, but Orale does not know to be intimidated.
She is naive to the nth degree.
Oh, yeah.
That's very true.
She's so naive that even little kid Goku would be like, what the heck?
I just love how, like, when the kid brother is trying to act tough, too, and she's just like, you're cute. And it's just like, the older brother's like, I told you not to wear that. It's just like, oh. And the thing is that the older brother saw what she did in gym class. Because he threw in gym class, too. It was in that sequence. And I'm like, dude, you saw what she did. Like, are you really trying to scare her?
Maybe he didn't think of that in raw strength potential. Though I do like that, because he tries to intimidate Orale with the punch the can, only for Orale to punch the freaking tree. His response was, friends?
Yeah. Well, and when he punches it, he goes, wow, that hurt. In his mind, he goes, wow, that hurt. And it's just like, she's like, I can do that too. Boom.
So once they decide to accept Orale into their friend's circle, they drive to Akane's sister's place for coffee. But the Popo show up, and we're not talking Mr. Popo.
That'd be more fun, though.
Unless you're watching Dragon Ball Abridged.
No, heck no.
You see, this leads to a low-speed chase. And it's the same cops from earlier. And when they command the kids to get off, Orale obliges.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You'd think they learned. You would think they learned.
They knew what was happening as soon as they saw her, too.
They knew that was the worst part. Like, as soon as they saw her, it was like, oh no.
Approaching the evening, Senbai is panicking, wondering where his daughter is. Made worse when the police call him to the station. He assumes she's hurt, but she's just fine, of course. The end!
I do like when he comes in, is like, "Is all right?" And you see the two banged up cops going, "She's fine."
I love how he sits there and like still nobody suspects that she's anything more than an extra strong, young high school kid. Like nobody suspects it.
I mean, they have a Frankenstein monster in their class. I mean, you know.
I'm like, but this is twice now that you guys have gotten your butts whipped by her on accident. Like, she did not mean to do it. She did what you told her to. You told her to get off. She got off. You have no one to blame for yourself on that one.
Yeah.
I like that in the I just want to point out that I like in the end credits we get a scene of Arale dressed as R2-D2.
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice that little random cute bit there. Just to show how big Star Wars was.
Coming up next, things get even crazier, which I shouldn't be surprised by. I mean, now that things are established, you can get crazier, but still, even by that metric, this is going to get weird.
Yeah. Oh, yes, it is.
On our next podcast episode, few pop culture hits in the 1980s burned as bright and then abruptly vanished from sight, like ALF. The sitcom Alien proved popular enough to earn two cartoons that ran concurrently from Deke, with the first one centering on old Gordon Shumway's life on the planet Melmac. Keep your cats out of sight of this episode in 2 weeks. Our next episode begins with Arale-chan goes to school, as a mole identifies the school for any of us who missed the first episode. And hey, let's check in on the music club. And presiding over it is a smoking dog.
I love the sequence.
After a jig, he asks if an ape, a rooster, a crow, and a pig are ready. Their idea of music is cacophonic. More than a little straining for the pig.
Yeah.
This is being broadcast over the PA system as Midoriya is assigning homework. Have fun!
I wish I had a teacher like that.
I do too.
Me too.
I try to be that teacher.
Same here.
By the time the kids have recovered from the surprise, the music club has busted the speaker in that homeroom. And finally, the pig can take it no more. He has to pass gas. Hey! 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 Hey!
What? Hey! What? That was
That's
funny.
What they said after he passed the gas.
Yeah, I was expecting you guys to join in.
Hey!
Hey! Hey!
Hey!
Hey!
Hey!
Hey! Hey!
Hey!
Hey!
Hey! Hey!
There we go.
Hey, hey! Okay, I'm done.
Hey!
Hey!
Hey! Akane has to explain the concept of clubs to Arale, and eventually offers her to show her around them, after some initial confusion, of course. Meanwhile, Taro is wandering the area and thinks because he's a hit with the girls, he's going to be the lead male in the manga, when Midori gets his attention. She says the sunglasses suit him, but they're not part of the dress code, so off they go!
I do have to say, for Japan, this is a pretty lenient dress code for the most part.
Yeah.
I know. Well, I also notice how no one in the school truly gets in trouble because we don't see anyone doing the traditional Japanese punishment of standing outside holding buckets of water.
Yeah, but I just know generally in Japan, like, they have like a uniform that everyone typically wears.
Yeah. But I almost feel like this is more of like, I don't know if Toriyama was going for a more Western style school setting.
Maybe he just thought drawing everyone in a uniform is boring.
That could be that too. He never really ever actually did anything, you know, boring. As we can tell from this show.
So as Taro reels in pain, he recovers to notice Arale talking to the head of the track and field club. Taro wants Arale to join baseball instead, and as he argues with the track and field head, in butts the sumo club representative.
Who's huge.
Yeah.
And then we meet Grandma Saru. Okay.
Alrighty then.
Even by this standard, she's random and unexplained. At least at this point.
I don't think she ever really becomes explained.
Well, Pem, Kyle, you guys would know.
I haven't done enough Dr. Slump enough to really know all the characters yet.
I think she just makes random appearances in commentary. It's been a while.
Okay, then.
Yeah, she's kind of that one character that just kind of pops up and you're just like, oh, it's her.
The various heads of the clubs are all fighting over Arale as Akane takes it upon herself to be her manager. And we see a procession of club representatives which get sillier and sillier. Was that Andre Agassi?
Yes.
Yes.
And right after him was Giant Baba.
Yep.
There's just all kinds of clubs, even a nightclub.
Which is a really good pun.
I like the research club.
Yes!
Unfortunately, though, it looks like the Mafia Club got ended pretty quickly.
Yeah, they didn't last long.
Yeah, unfortunately, the Doctor Club was there to check. Dr. Slump even pops in for his fatty club, since he otherwise doesn't have much screen time this episode. In the end, Arale wants to try them all, and starts with baseball.
Oh boy.
Yeah, the other kids wonder what's gotten into Taro by his wanting this little pipsqueak, but he and Pisake know better.
Poor kid. Yeah.
I also like how that freaking catcher, like, demolishes a, like, giant rice ball in almost one.
Oh, yeah.
And then
eats the tea kettle.
And then he eats the tea kettle, and it's like, oh, dude, if you're trying to intimidate her, that doesn't work.
Once she pitches, you can guess what happens next. The resulting launch sends the catcher hurtling through the Earth's crust.
Yeah, it takes him a while to get out of that mess.
Yeah, he leaves a big hole in a mountain, which only makes me think of one thing.
What's that?
This hole was made for me.
Oh, God.
You know, part of me with Taro, I was like, Taro, you know how hard she throws. You watched her do it in gym class. I would almost been like, if I was Taro, I'd be like, okay, not too hard.
Well, I think he also wanted to just prove his point to that guy, since that guy was all being you know.
That's fair, too. I mean, that's fair.
Fortunately, they're in a comedy manga, so, you know, he's
okay.
They're
so good. Yeah, he won't die. No one dies in this.
Even though he wants his mommy.
Yeah, he does. I love that.
Track and field is next, as Arale just laps the other kids, and her long jump makes the captain question her life decisions. How else do you explain that reaction?
She's having a mental breakdown.
Well, yeah. I think almost everyone on the team was starting to have a mental breakdown.
Grandma Saru says that's one sick jump.
And eats a cookie. She's like, that's
what I'm saying. I'm pretty sure that's not the literal translation, but that made me laugh a lot more. So.
I agree.
Senbai has to stop an intrusive ad for Shonen Jump before Arale tries the high jump. Oh, now I get it. Her leap sends her to the clouds, where thunder ogres, or oni of some sort, are surprised at the human child. And her landing has a deep impact on everyone around her. Club after club after club she tries. And her lack of understanding of both typical procedures and the concept of modesty make for some visual gags. But in the end, she has no interest in any of the clubs. She just wants to be with her friend Akane, which is just so sweet.
And adorable.
It is. And even Akane, you could tell, is a little touched by that.
It's kind of funny. Arale manages to be both, like, incredibly scary and maybe even creepy at times, but also adorable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Arale joins Akane's club. The Delinquent Girls Club.
That's officially saying F the cops.
Yeah. And she ends up terrifying everyone in that club except for Akane.
Oh, yeah. Akane knows now she's in charge.
Yeah.
This is also not what Miss Midori expected.
Also, by thanks to watching various essays on video games and some anime in the last couple years, I know that the term for female delinquent is Sukubon, if I remember right.
So, very good.
Thank you, Jeremy Parrish, and your talk about Renegade.
Mm-hmm. So after the commercial break, pigs fly as Dr. Slump enjoys a drink at the start of the next segment. Aurelia is next to him, playing with a little lizard kid, as she asks if she's the most perfect android. The echo effect in their voices signals a dream sequence to me, because the flying pigs were frankly normal for Penguin Village, as far as I'm concerned.
Indeed.
I think I need to point out that, that's not your typical lizard kid. That's straight up Godzilla.
Yeah. Yeah.
I never loved a scene with him so much as just lining back in that chair, sipping on a glass of cognac. He's just like, I'm the most perfect person in the world.
Indeed.
The big, ceremonious reception that follows just reeks of Dr. Slump fantasizing too, as the scientific community marvels at his creation. Our title for this segment is It Is Not There. Uh-oh.
So I have to ask all of the gentlemen who were watching this, how red did you guys get watching this?
I didn't.
I know, only because I'd read the manga first, like a couple weeks ago. So yeah.
I've seen this and read the manga before. Granted, my memory is not the best on it because it's been like at least I think 10 to 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I've raised a daughter and stuff, so this is not.
You kind of were prepared.
Yeah.
How about you, James?
Well, speaking for myself, I had to check to see if blushing with blue fur turned it purple, and no, it doesn't.
No, it just hides the blush. I was laughing throughout this whole thing just because I knew it couldn't be going where it was trying to go. But it was hilarious that it was trying to go there. It was making you want to go, your brain to go there. That's all I'm going to say.
This is like the first episode where we really get to see Toriyama's, how should I say, more...
adult
side? Ribald side?
Uh-huh. Yeah, that might be the way to look at it. Which weirdly reminds me of... I remember an interview where he got asked who his favorite character was, and he said it was Kid Goku because he loves writing naive characters because he's such a pervert. Was Toriyama's response?
Oh, I must be. I would think he was going to say Master Yoshi because it was so close to his personality.
Well, I read some earlier when Z came around. He said Piccolo's his favorite.
He did say thing. That.
He changes every interview I've seen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, as an artist and creator, I can say that even my favorite characters change from time to time. Yeah. So
I think if you ask him in each thing he made, he had a favorite character in each one.
So Raleigh walks in on a sleeping Slump and wakes him up with her inquiry about missing something. While changing for gym class, the other girls noticed she's lacking something, without saying precisely what. And, you know, Senpai does not want her to say it for the exact reason I don't want to say it myself. This is an all-ages podcast!
And believe it or not, this was an all-ages show. Well, in Japan, anyways.
Everyone's mind went into the gutter in 3, 2, 1. There.
But she wants one, too, and won't take her creator's objections since she's supposed to be perfect. Just like his fantasy.
That's a low blow.
It turns out he's never even seen one before. Quick shots of classical art follow, ending with the Mona Lisa sticking out her tongue.
That was a good shot.
Now, Arale, in her traditional naivete, has a simple solution. Get a girl to show it to him, by force if necessary.
Were you planning to turn me into?
I know, I love that part.
He briefly ponders making her a boy.
He even offers to make her a boy. He even asks her, why don't I just make you a boy? I know what that looks like.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he indicates, like, I know what that, yeah.
He's like, I know what that looks like. She's like, no.
But Arale suggests seeing one in secret, and this gives Senbai an idea. He starts working with unsettling glee, and Arale wants to show the end result to everyone.
She's like, no, you don't.
Senbai works all through the night and comes up with the most powerful X-ray specs ever. The goggles can see through non-living things, leaving only the living left to the viewer, to the embarrassment of an anthropomorphized dog.
Poor dog.
Arale tries the goggles on, and when she looks at her creator... Okay, I have no delicate way to say this other than she sees Slumps slump and wants one.
She tells her no.
Absolutely not.
He's like, heck no. Although he did offer to give her one,
I know,
not that long ago.
But I mean, at that time, she's not 100% knowing what he means. Also, I do like the gag where when Slump puts on the glasses and he notices Arale's gone and doesn't, and then he's like, oh, right, you're a robot.
Yeah, he's like, oh, wait.
Their mission begins. And as a pig walks by, Senbai wonders where all the eye candy is. That's gotta be Toriyama.
Yep. just assume it's Toriyama. Just go right there.
He stumbles upon Aoi-chan from the cafe, casually reading a book as she waits for the bus. And the camera pans over her body in a way that made me feel not particularly comfortable. He tries to convince himself it's for science, as Arale notices him drooling.
Mm-hmm. Cat-like tread, da-da-da-da-da-da. Okay.
With cat-like tread, he gets into position and puts on the goggles, only to find Taro and Pisuke.
Ooh! Oh! Oh!
As he complains that they're boring to look at, Aoi calls out for Dr. Skunk. Eventually, seeing this as a chance for a close look, he makes awkward small talk, and then puts on the goggles when she's back to reading. The resulting peak sends him right over the bench. As he tries to get a closer look, a cat jumps out of her basket and sits on Aoi's lap. Premi, no. Chrissy, no. Kyle, no.
Oh, come on. Come on. Oh. I mean, that's how... It's a perfect pussy shot.
That's a great visual gag. I didn't even know if that was a term they used in Japan for that.
Well, it is now.
What?
I'm pretty sure it was.
What can you say, James? Cat got your tongue?
Oh, I want to throw one thing out real quick. I'm looking at the manga going along with this. And there's actually a shot in the manga of where he's actually wearing the goggles, looking up at a naked Superman.
Oh, wow. Well, Superman does have X-ray vision. I'm sure
he glanced
back. Oh, my goodness.
So, Senbai tries to get the cat to scat with a stick. And the cat reacts with claws of fury before Aoi gets on the bus.
Good for the cat. I'm going to be honest. Good for the cat.
As Arale gets the goggles and looks at Taro's, oh, good heavens.
She sees something small.
I really got more than I bargained for with this episode.
Yeah, you did. Yes, you did.
Naked Superman's in the episode, too.
Yep.
Pisuke spots Midori. And Dr. Slump scrambles for the goggles. And it's pandemonium!
Yep. Yes, flying super naked Superman is in the background while we see Midori.
Yes! Yes, he is!
Also, I'm not going to lie, when they're doing all the sound effects for Senbai's reaction to seeing her naked, and like Godzilla and the roar appeared, I lost it.
Oh my god, that was so perfect. Oh my god, I forgot. Yeah. It was just like, oh my god, how much more epic are they trying to make this? Because this is hysterical.
Like I said, Pandemonium!
Hey, Kyle, you're the kaiju fan. Does that happen when you see a cute girl?
Shut up.
I believe the answer to the question is yes.
To verify, we should probably ask Justin.
Justin, please comment below. Does this happen when you see a cute girl?
I'm going to get a black eye for that, I'm sure.
Oh, no. No, because it's tomorrow's Friday. He knows what happens to his character.
So, resolving for that it's for Arale's sake, he makes a mad dash at Midori, forgetting that he can't see the moped she's riding on, and crashes right into it. And as Midori asks why he did it, Arale asks if he saw her belly button. All of this over a belly button.
Yep.
Should have just let her say it at the start.
Yep.
Well, it's... If you're going to be a belly dancer, you kind of need one.
Yeah.
Unless you're doing... What is it? It's on the tip of my tongue. Certain Egyptian classical style that uses a more modest outfit.
I don't know.
Got me.
I'll edit it in later.
There you go. Do future dreams.
I don't know. I suddenly got reminded of anime and manga Dragon Half, where... has a girl that's half dragon, half human, and the elf girl asks her, hey, if you're hatched out of an egg, why do you have a belly button? And she just responds with, I was born under very weird circumstances.
There are just some things you just don't want answers to. The moral of the story is, why don't you let her finish the full story before you just assume what she's going to say?
Also, it's a great setup, I gotta admit. Like, this is one of those great bait and switch gags. The whole thing builds up, making you think it's one thing, only for it to be revealed to be something completely different.
Yeah,
exactly.
And it's kind of funny to me. So obviously, this segment. If you actually go through the whole entire run of it. Spoiler alert, Senbai does eventually end up with Midori, and they do have a kid, so.
A child named Turbo.
Yeah, they named the kid Turbo.
The style of dance I was looking for, darn it, now it's slipped out of my mouth again.
You can add it in post.
Yeah, you can add it in post.
Yeah, I'll just do it then. When the series ran its course in 1986, this was far from the end. Arale and the rest would briefly pop up in the Dragon Ball manga during the Red Ribbon Army Saga, where she and Goku team up to battle the adversaries the arc was named after. And the corresponding anime story would feature her and her cast appearing in the English language via Funimation for the first officially released time. But before that, Harmony Gold wanted to take a stab at the series, and dubbed the first episode with new names for everyone except Arale, and omitting scenes like the cross-dressing bit. It was never picked up.
Of course not.
Kind of like their dub of Dragon Ball that they Irony Gold also tried to do at one point.
I can't even begin to imagine what they'd have tried to do with the second episode.
I mean, like, when you cut out the good bits, it's not going to get picked up.
Saidi! Saidi is the dance style.
Ah.
There we go.
Now I don't have to edit.
Perfect.
Dubs do exist in other languages, though, making Dr. Slump arguably far better known in Europe than here in the U.S.
Well, that's only fair. It took the U.S. a while before we jumped on the Dragon Ball Z bandwagon, unlike most the other world.
Which, to me, is hilarious, because I actually would watch Dragon Ball Z in Canada before it actually made it here through Toonami. So I kind of knew about it before it actually came to the U.S. for Toonami, because I would watch it in Canada when we go to Canada.
And on the subject of Dragon Ball, Arale would continue to show up here and there in that franchise, including several video games, notoriously in Dragon Ball Z Budokai Tenkaichi 3.
Yeah, she is practically unbeatable in that game.
Well, Arale also appears again in the more current Dragon Ball Super series,
where she takes out Vegeta.
Yeah, she takes out Vegeta because it's like they have the conflict of how does a fighting anime fight against a comedy anime character, and that's the whole plot because all the insane goofy crap she can do compared to Goku and Vegeta.
You come to learn out that Bulma and Senbei actually know each other, and they're there for a conference at the Capsule Corps headquarters.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, you better be scared, you spiky-haired, super serious weirdo.
Well, no. Then it turns out, like, they basically, she ends up meeting Goku again as an adult, and so now they're about to have, like, a clash of the Kamehameha and her breath laser, and if they don't stop, they're capable of destroying the planet.
Oh my god.
So it certainly doesn't stop with Dragon Ball. Arale, Senbei, and company have starred in 11 feature films through 1999, the first five of which would get a release here in the U.S. with subtitles. There would also be a revival manga Toriyama would supervise, Takao Koyama and Katsuyori Nakasuru. He would supervise them on. In 1993, called The Brief Return of Dr. Slump. A second anime with a redesigned Arale would last for 74 episodes in 1997 through 1999. Incredibly, this is the version that arrived with subtitles on U.S. television in 2001 on Tubi.
Unfortunately, it's no longer on Tubi. I know, I looked.
Yeah.
So it is not Tubi.
Nice.
That's good.
The most recent animated story was a 5-minute one-shot, Dr. Mashirito and Abale-chan, about an evil robot rival to Arale, in 2007, and was put in front of the One Piece movie, The Desert Princess and the Pirates, Adventures in Alabasta.
Nice.
Nice.
Arale's influence even reached outside the Shonen Jump world, as her trademark airplane arms running and the tanuki suit she'd frequently wear, especially in the intro, would appear on a certain Italian plumber come Super Mario Bros. 3.
Ho-ho!
It's-a me!
Mario!
Also, the classic Sonic the Hedgehog title screens of the first two games owe their look to Dr. Slump's own title screen.
That's very true.
Like we said, Toriyama's inspired a lot of people. I mean, heck, even like Sonic getting 7 Chaos Emeralds to turn Super Sonic, that's 100% Dragon Ball Z.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that just about does it.
I will say I have not watched any of the 90s revival series, late 90s revival series, but yeah, it's not just Arale gets redesigned. Everybody gets redesigned. And yeah, Arale and like Senbei are like the only ones that are instantly recognizable. Some of the other characters, you won't even recognize them when you see them in that revival show.
Yeah, but you know what? That's kind of the theme of the 90s. Like everything in the 90s got redesigned to some extent.
It also had new voice actors in the Japanese one for some reason, despite the fact they returned to the original voice actors for Arale and Dragon Ball Super. So I guess they just decanonized that along with Dragon Ball GT.
We're just going to assume that this did not happen, and we're just going to pretend.
It's also kind of interesting, though, seeing the 90s revival series, because since everything's redesigned for it, it's using Toriyama's more angular style that came from Dragon Ball Z, but with the Dr. Slump characters, so it's odd looking, I'll say that. It definitely looks very different.
Well, as long as they didn't pick up the Dragon Ball Z storytelling of like, we're gonna take 7 episodes to power up, 20 episodes to fight, and then 17 episodes to discuss what happened after the fight. Like,
and they still need filler.
Yeah, exactly.
It's worth mentioning that stuff flies a lot faster in the manga.
It always, yeah, that's sometimes why I was like, I kind of prefer the manga to the anime for this, because I have a life.
Well, before we go restock the breakfast cereal, Kyle, do you have anything you want to plug?
Unfortunately, not at the moment.
Not even your YouTube channel?
Or oh,
the
no,
podcast,
no, no, no.
Okay, the podcast you're on?
I take it back. I'm sorry. Sorry, it's been a long week. So yeah, if you'd like to find it, I have a YouTube channel. You can find me under Kylepedia, where I do toy reviews. And I also have another podcast. It's a comic book podcast I do with a couple of friends called the Next Issue Podcast, which we haven't really been uploading stuff on like to the normal like, you know, audio places, but you can find us find a whole bunch of videos up on our Next Issue Podcast on YouTube. And we do live 2-hour shows every Saturday, which I will unfortunately not be on this one because I'll be out of town.
Very cool.
All right. Well, yeah. Let's go get some Reese's Puffs, because look who's on the box. It's Goku.
Whoa.
Seriously, whoa. I was in Wegmans just this morning, and there he was.
He'll pop out of nowhere on you.
I'm Coco for Cocoa Puffs. It's kind of bad, because I'm not hearing that in his dub voice. I'm hearing that in the Dragon Ball abridged voice.
Okay, we need to purge that from you, don't we?
Good night, everybody.
Bye,
see
everyone.
Ya.
The Penny and James got a sort of hopefully funny cartoon podcast.
The preceding podcast is a co-production of the Mighty Monkey Corporation and Artificial Orange Studios. The theme song is written, composed, and performed by Shawn Michael Smith. For questions and comments, email me at james@fc3roc.org.